Working of galvanometer. Galvanometer works on the principle of torque and anti-torque. Who experiences the torque? Answer, the current flowing in the coil. The coil is kept in a magnetic field. Here, the torque on when current flow in coil placed in magnetic field, it experiences a torque. And this torque tau is equal to NIAB sine theta, where N is number of turns, I is current, A is area, B is strength of the magnetic field, and theta is the angle between area vector and magnetic field. Okay, if I see it from the top, this is the coil. It has got certain area. I am seeing this coil in this way. This is the coil. See it from the top. You will see only this. It rotates, goes like this. Now, where is the area vector? Answer, this is the area vector, or this is the area vector. So when it rotates, you will see area vector like this. Area vector like this, perpendicular to this line. So this is the coil, this is area vector, and there is a magnetic field over here. At any time, this is the coil. Here is the magnetic field, B, this is area vector, A, and this is the angle between area vector and the coil. When it rotates, the angle changes. When the angle change, the torque quantity will also change. So the torque keeps on changing between 0 to maximum value. Here, so there is something, we make a drastic change. We say that the torque should depend only and only upon current. Torque should depend only on current. The torque should not depend on theta. But according to equation, it depends upon theta, because when it rotates, theta keeps on changing. We make a certain arrangement so that theta do not change. How it can be done? It can be done with certain provisions in magnetic field. As I have shown in the construction, the magnet heads are made cylindrical. If you see it from the top, if you see it from the side, you will see a cylinder. If you see it from the top, cut it, and it will look to you like this. And this is going inside. Now, this is fitted with North Pole, and this is fitted with a South Pole. Okay. Now, we put a soft iron cylinder in it. Here is the soft iron cylinder. The gap is very small. On this soft iron cylinder, we have fitted one frame passing through the center. On this frame, we have the coil. Here is the coil. Number of coils are wound. Everything we are looking from the top, so we see it in one plane. Now, where is the magnetic field? Because of this particular shape, north, the magnetic field line start from the north and it goes here, and then it has to go to south. So here it goes to south. This is the direction of magnetic field. Now, from here, we find another magnetic field line. The magnetic field line has to be at right angle to the surface, so it goes at right angle to this surface. But if it goes right angle to this surface, you see it is directed towards center. It cannot cross it and go on this side, because crossing of two lines is not permissible. So what we observe, it goes like this, and we observe that there is a line which is coming like this. We see a line here and we see a line coming out here, magnetic field line. Here is a magnetic field line, center, and here it goes out. Here is a magnetic field line going towards center, and here it goes out. But this is violation of the principle that magnetic field do not cross each other. We can explain it, that really magnetic fields are not crossing each other, and this magnetic field is basically, this one is going this way, this one is going this way, this one is this way, this is going this way. Magnetic field line, magnetic field line, magnetic field line, magnetic field line, magnetic field line. No lines have crossed each other. But when we don't see this, we see only this. What appears to us? Magnetic field lines, magnetic field line, this. So remember, this is the actual shape, and this is what appear in the gap. This is gap. This is core, cylinder core, and this is magnet. The direction of magnetic field is in the direction of radius. Therefore, this magnetic field is called radial magnetic field. Radial magnetic field. Okay, now you understand what is a radial magnetic field, whose direction is like this and not like this. This is a uniform magnetic field, this is a radial magnetic field. In galvanometer, we make radial field. Why do we make radial field? At any time, this is the coil. How much is the angle between magnetic field and area vector? This is area vector, and how much is the angle? 90. The coil is along the magnetic field, angle with the area vector is 90. This has become 90. Okay. Suppose it rotates, and after rotation, it comes to this direction. This. If the coil is in this direction, then it is along the magnetic field again. Here is the area vector, and the angle is 90 degrees. Same. If it rotates this way further, it comes in this direction. When it comes in this direction, again it is along this magnetic field, and angle with the area vector and magnetic field is again 90. So, in whichever condition it rotates, it is always and always along the magnetic field and the direction of magnetic field and area vector. They make right angle to each other wherever it rotates. So for every situation, for every position of its rotation, this theta always remain 90 degree, and it has become a constant. How much is sine 90? Sine 90 is equal to 1. So this thing we write here, due to magnetic field radial, due to magnetic field being radial, theta is always 90 degree, therefore torque is always NIAB, always. That means for every rotation, that means for every time for every rotation, it is unaffected by rotation angle theta. This is the torque. Now you see, torque depends upon what? Current. If current increase or decrease, the torque will change. It will not change according to the position, which is the original one. So this we have changed to this condition. We will write it now. Torque depend on current only. We have given a certain amount of current to the galvanometer and it starts making torque, and because of the torque it starts rotating. Now when it goes on rotating, what happens? When it is rotating, you have seen that there is a spindle, and with the spindle there is a hair spring. This hair spring gets tightened up when this rotates. When the coil rotates, it becomes tight. When this becomes tight, it creates a torque in opposite direction, that is counter torque. So the spring gets strained and produce a counter torque. You can say it is a counter torque, or you can say it is a storing torque. So it produces a counter or storing torque. This torque is equal to K phi. What is K? That is torque per unit rotation. When we rotate the spring by 1 degree, the torque is 10 Newton meter. That is K. If the spring is very soft, we rotate it by 1 degree, torque is only 2 Newton per degree. So this is the constant K. What is phi? Phi is the rotation. If you rotate it by 1 degree, multiply by 1. If you rotate it by 10 degree, multiply by 10. If you rotate by 30 degree, multiply by 30. So for angle of rotation phi, the torque is K phi. And when the coil start rotating it, the spring gets tightened. 1 degree rotation, counter torque, 1 phi. 2 degree rotation, counter torque, 2 phi. 10 degree rotation, counter torque, 10 phi. So you see, counter torque goes on increasing. Mind it. Counter torque goes on increasing. Is the applied torque changing? No. Applied torque is fixed because we are not increasing current. We are not increasing N. No A, no B. Nothing is getting increased. So this torque applied by the coil is constant, say 70 Newton meter. This goes on increasing by degree 10, 30, 40, 50, 70. When the counter torque becomes 70 and this applied torque is 70, both become equal and it stops rotating. Think of that situation. When it stops rotating, at that time what has happened? The torque by coil is equal to torque by spring. What is the torque by coil? NIAB. What is the torque by spring? K phi. Then can you isolate I? Yes. I is equal to K phi divided by NAB. NAB. In this, what is K? Constant for the spring. Spring constant. Spring torque constant. When 1 degree rotates, whatever torque is produced. N, is a constant for the coil, number of turns. A is area of the coil, that is also constant. B is strength of magnetic field. During rotation, it is also not changing. So this is also a constant. So this are constants. If all these are constants, then I is proportionate to phi. So more is the rotation, more is the current, or more is the current, more is the rotation. So here phi becomes a tool, a measurement of current. If the current increase 3 times, phi will increase 3 times. If the current increase 7 times, phi will increase 7 times. So we get a measurement. If we calibrate it, then we have to calibrate it once for 1 phi and then multiply it with anything. So the angle of rotation of the indicator, here was indicator and this was scale. When it rotates, this rotation increases, that means current through the coil is increases. So this is measurement of the electric current. This is how it works. We give current to it and it gives us what? It gives us phi. And we do calibration. For that phi, we write down with a standard meter, with a comparison meter, how much will be the current. So we write here 1 milliampere, 2 milliampere, 3 milliampere, like that. Whatever is the current, the same will be the phi. So this is working of galvanometer. In this working, there are certain more quantities. Which are those quantities? Our formula is I, current in the coil, is equal to K upon NAB into phi. These are all constants of the components of the galvanometer. Number of turns, area, coil, B, magnet in the galvanometer, K, spring constant of the spring fitted in the galvanometer. So all these are parts of galvanometer. So we write it as a constant of galvanometer, G, phi. So I is equal to G into phi, where G is galvanometer constant. Okay, so this is our equation for the current. And how much is G is equal to? G is equal to current upon phi. This is galvanometer constant. Now, can we measure this galvanometer constant? If we make phi is equal to 1 degree, then G is equal to I. So the current required in a galvanometer, which will give a deflection of 1 degree, that current is equal to the galvanometer constant. Again, current which gives a deflection of 1 degree is numerically equal to the galvanometer constant. This is galvanometer constant, and you can always find it in practicals, in the experiments in your lab. So I will write it once again. This is galvanometer constant. Now, galvanometer is a very sensitive device. Sensitive. We must define what is sensitivity of a galvanometer, and we can always define it in mathematical terms, in calculation terms. So what is sensitivity? There are two galvanometers. This gives 1 degree deflection with 1 milliampere. This gives 1 degree deflection with 4 milliamperes. When I give 4, then only it will show 1 degree. This 1 milliampere, 1 degree, which is more sensitive? You will say this is more sensitive. A very small current is able to deflect. Here, if there is 1 ampere, it will not move. You won't even know. So this is sensitive. Then what is the measurement of sensitivity? the measurement of sensitivity is angle phi per unit current. If I give 1 milliampere here, it gives, suppose there is another galvanometer, I give 1 milliampere, it gives 10 degree. Here I give 1 milliampere, it gives only 5 degree. So this is more sensitive. So how I found it? 10 degree per ampere. Here 5 degree per ampere. So sensitivity, that is current sensitivity. What is the formula for current sensitivity? I will write it here. Current sensitivity, that is current sensitivity, is equal to phi divided by I. This is current sensitivity. How can we increase, to increase current sensitivity? How to increase current sensitivity? Phi should be large. Okay, this Is is equal to phi upon I. What is value of phi upon I? See here, bring I on this side and rest everything on this side. So what we get here, phi upon I is equal to NAB upon K. So this is NAB upon K. This is measurement of current sensitivity. Measurement of current sensitivity. When current sensitivity will be more? When number of turns are more, area is large, magnets are very strong. And this should be small. How K will be small? K is spring constant. How spring constant will be small? Answer, the spring should be soft. So once again, number of turns should be more, area of the coil should be large, magnet should be strong, and spring should be soft. Then this is a very sensitive galvanometer. Understand? Now there is another term known as voltage sensitivity. So voltage sensitivity is what? V sensitivity. Voltage sensitivity is phi upon V, and this can be, V is equal to I into R. So we can write it phi upon R into I, and phi upon I is equal to NAB upon K. So this is NAB upon K, and here is R. This is what? Voltage sensitivity. Please note it down and remember it. Voltage sensitivity. For this, resistance should also be less. How will you make the resistance less? If you decrease the length, resistance will be less. But if you decrease the length, number of turns will also become less. So you cannot decrease the length. If to increase the sensitivity, you increase the number of turns, then resistance will also increase. How to do it? Answer is, we will use a thicker wire. Number of turns will be increased, but the wire will be taken as thick wire, so resistance will be less. This is voltage sensitivity. Voltage sensitivity, current sensitivity, galvanometer constant, you have done it. I upon phi is galvanometer constant, I upon phi. So galvanometer constant was equal to K upon NAB. So these are the required quantities, and I is equal to this much. This is the measurement. This is how galvanometer work. For a very small current, it gives certain deflection. If it is very sensitive, then for a very small current, it will give the full deflection. If we want to measure a higher current than that, what can we do? The answer is, if we want to measure a higher current than this total deflection current, then we have to make certain changes, and by changing that, we can measure any other current. In that case, this galvanometer is termed as ampere meter or ammeter. So in next lecture, we will see what is an ammeter and how a galvanometer can be converted into an ammeter.